trials or distributed or decentralized clinical trials, and then real world data collection, PROs, and so on. These are new needs from the pharma industry. So what we did at Andaman 7 is create a solution that tries to address these various modes of needs or problems. It's composed of a patient-facing mobile application, which is free for all patients, as I said. It's a personal health record, so it's a way to store all of your data, but we store it only on the smartphone. There is nothing stored in the cloud. And beside that, we have a platform that allows to exchange data after patient consent. There's always patient consent. And then if the platform is used, then the exchange of data is peer-to-peer. So that means that it, of course, uses the internet, but it doesn't store any data in the cloud by default. I say by default because when we will come to DataVaults, you will see that the way of operation is a bit different, but this is the basic Andaman 7 application and platform outside of the DataVault system. So by default, the patients store their data on their smartphone and only on their smartphone, and nobody has access to that data except the patient, not even us as a company. What does it look like? It looks like, it looks like a simple application. So you can see on the left side that you can store information about your drugs, documents, consultations, information, allergies, previous conditions. You can see on the middle screen that you can have images and documents, in this case PDF, but it could be Word or text files. And on the right side, you can see that you can manage more than one health record. For example, your children's record or your parents if they are older and they are not comfortable managing their data themselves. But it's more than a personal health record. It's also a tool to coordinate work with hospitals. So in this case, you see a new icon under the red arrow, which is expanded on the two screens on the right side. And there you can see that there is a special, we call it dashboard if you want, for the patients with a specific condition. In this case, it's coagulation problem. Blood condition, and there are a number of drugs that are specific to that or that can interact with that, and there's also some test results which are important. One of them is called INR, like you can see on the bottom right. And so in these two screens, what we do is collect all of the data that is important, whether it's a medication, a lab test result, or another condition, or anything that is important for that condition. We also provide questionnaires, so doctors can ask questions to patients and patients can answer to doctors. And then as you can see on the middle screen, there's a help section there where there are documents and possibly videos and other training materials that are provided, for example, by doctors or others that will then be available to patients and only to the patient with that specific condition. So you see here that we can very easily fine-tune the application to some conditions so that it's really adapted to the condition. This is an example of another use case where it's more about a clinical trial. So here the middle screen shows, the middle and right screen show a simple questionnaire that the patients first have to consent. So the patient consent to being part of the study. And then when they have consented, they receive electronic questionnaires like this, which they can either fill in manually or data can be grabbed from their personal health record and shared with a research agency or institution. Of course, data is anonymized in all of those cases, that's the law. Right, so but that means that the patients that collect their data from their hospitals, from their labs, or from other mobile apps can store everything in their personal health record and then use that to contribute to research. So in a sense, if I need to summarize the Andaman 7 platform still outside of the DataVault initiative, is that what we're trying to do is to help patients, empower patients, giving them access to their data, all of their data, without any conditions. And GDPR goes in that direction, as you know, but also patients' laws, patient rights laws. Then we try to help manage disease. That's with the care industry, doctors, hospitals, and so on. And then we help to evaluate the outcomes of new drugs and so on for the pharma industry. And all of that with one unique platform and for all conditions. So we are not specialized in diabetes or cancer or heart problems. We can manage all of them together on the same platform. Now, why are we interested in the DataVaults platform and what do we plan to do there? Well, as you know, DataVaults as Yuri explained, is a global platform for any type of data about citizen. And we take care, if you want, of a subset of those data, which are the health data. And so we speak as much about patients as citizens, but still, we are focused on that special type of data, and that's a very specific type of data, as you know. It's probably more critical or more sensible, type of data. So Andaman 7 will be the health data demonstrator for the DataVaults platform. What we hope to contribute and to get out of this project is that to provide to patients more ways to contribute to research. So beside our own systems to contribute to research, if patients upload their data to first their personal data vault, then the cloud data vault, and make their data available in anonymized format mostly to others, that's going to open up the ways patients can contribute to research. And we have seen studies where 85% of patients agree, of course, under some conditions, to share their data. And that's without being paid also. So there's a lot of empathy in patients, and they agree to share their data as long as they have some control. And then another element that we hope will be useful in that project is the reverse. So if data comes in my data vault, store personal vault from other sources, I would like to keep them and bring them back to my local mobile phone so that I can have control over that anytime, including when I don't have any connection to the internet, because Andaman 7 works even if you're not connected to the internet, since all the data is offline. And then finally, what we hope to contribute is the specific elements about security and privacy that are related to health data. And voila, I finished 5 seconds early. Yuri, I hope you'll be happy with the timing.
Thank you, Vincent, for this very interesting presentation. So our next speaker is Paolo Boscolo from Municipality di Prato, from Comune di Prato. And to participants of the session, I invite you to leave your questions, if you have any, to Vincent, me, or other presenters in the chat. Paolo?
Okay, can you see my screen? Just a second.
You need to switch between, yes. Make it yes. Cool.
It's okay now?
Yes. Yes.
So I will be very quick because I'm Paolo Boscolo. I'm working for the Prato City Council here in Italy, and we are involved in the project just as a pilot site. So we would like to test the possible usage of the platform that will be offered by the project in our context. Which is our context. So we will try to use the platform in 3 possible ways. The first one is related to the policy concerning mobility in the mobility area, and which is the scope of the scenario of this pilot. We, of course, use to make policies in mobility, we need data. All these policies are based on data. We normally use probes, we use surveys or other information like that in order to modify our mobility plan. So that are very important. What we'd like to do with the platform is to use the platform to collect data from users, directly from the users. And this is a different scenario respect to what is happening now, where data are normally sold as by third parties. So what we hope is to offer to our office the possibility to use the platform to make analytics on this data, provided by the users, and so this analytics to find a better way to move around the city. What we have done till now is we have identified, of course, the pilot scenario. We have contributed to the technical requirement for the platform. We have analyzed all the privacy issues coming from the usage of this platform, and of course, identifying the key KPI to evaluate the success of the experiment. And we have involved, of course, the office of the administration that is in charge of mobility problems. The second usage of the platform is very similar to the previous one, but is related to the cultural and touristic issues of the city. The city is a city close to Florence, so we have problem in promoting the city for tourism because we have a bigger city, a most important city near to us, but the tourism is something that is increasing also in our city. It's a medieval city. And we have also the problem of promoting the cultural event in the city. So again, to do that, data are always important because we need to know which are the preferences of the people, how the people participated in previous event, which are their impression about what happened in the city, et cetera, et cetera. So again, we have involved our office in charge for cultural planning in the city and for tourism planning. And we have identified the story, the technical requirement, involved the city administration office. And we have found a way, like in the previous experiment, to involve citizens in this pilot in order to see how they can react in the usage of, by the usage of the platform. But we have also another third kind of experiment we would like to do with the platform that is related to the problem of distributing the certified information that the city council manages on behalf of the user because of the law that is mandatory telling us to do that. For example, the certificates. The population registry produces a lot of certificates that the users, the citizen used to demonstrate something to our third parties. You know, there is also a European principle of the once only, it's the once only principle that that oblige us as a public administration to avoid to ask many times citizens about information we already have. So what we are trying to do with the platform is something different with respect to the management of big data, huge data set. But we are trying to use the possibility for the platform to keep in the user space very sensitive information like certificates and to use the platform to show this sensitive information to the third users, the third party that are interested at the moment they are interested. So we will try to connect the DataVault platform to our population registry and use the platform to download constantly the updated version of the certificates that are maintaining the platform. And I could say it's something similar to the Andaman application where the data are the personal data concerning medication, radiography, and so on. In this case, we are dealing with certificates and for different purposes, of course. And also in this case, we have involved the city council offices that are in charge of that. And we are trying to involve a third party that is a typical institution that is asking for certificates when citizens go there, in particular the center that helps citizens in fiscal procedures to the tax declaration or things like that. But which is the point of view of a local authority, in particular here in Italy, respect the DataVault proposal? Of course, there are many kinds of considerations. The first kind is the business model. In other presentation, I found a very interesting observation concerning how currently the market of data is organized. And of course, it looks like a colonialism or monopoly situation now, because in particular, as a public administration, even if we are managing our citizens, and so we are able to collect, if necessary, data from them, for some policies, we are now obliged to ask this data to a third party that is making business with them. It seems very strange. So DataVaults can help us to move to a data sovereignty situation where the flow of this data is completely different, and it can generate advantages for everyone in a win-win situation. Because in fact, the DataVaults is trying to offer also a mechanism through which the citizens that offer data to the platform in order to be provided to a third party, let's say the public administration, in this case, in our pilot cases, he will receive back a remuneration for that. That is not the case now. The users of the platform that collect data are just receiving a service that is considered by the citizen equivalent to the value of the data they provide to the manager of these services. It's not always true. Of course, because we can have a direct contact with our citizen when we are asking data from them, we can have a more detailed and more targeted data collection activity. And so this can lead to a better policy in our city. Other consideration concerning business is the sustainability of the scheme. We are trying to analyze in the project how a platform like that can be operated, in which way there will be a company that will operate it, or it could be used by any administration wanting to deal with the citizen, with data, citizen data. And so the public administration could be, for example, the operator of the platform that can offer to the citizen this platform and be a sort of broker of data also towards third party. So other kind of a consideration, the privacy. Of course, a platform like that can offer, because of the technologies that are used inside, better privacy preservation for citizens. And there are a lot of mechanisms of explicit consent where the citizen has to say yes every time some third party is wanting to use and exploit the data he has provided to the platform. That is also not true at the moment, because when you say to Google, you can use my data, you say yes for everything normally, or no, you are not interested to see which kind we added condition, you say yes, and that's all. And there are also other technologies like anonymization and the creation of personas that can allow the third party interested in usage data, in using the data, to use them in a very anonymous way, or in a way they cannot relate the data to the person that owns the data. So it's another way to increase the privacy of citizens. And the next point is important in the context of a public administration. In case the public administration uses a platform like that, and in particular, in the case of the administration using the platform as the operator of the platform, what is created is a stronger relation between the administration and the citizen. And the citizen can see the administration as a sort of guarantor in the exploitation of the data over the third party. And this can create local business, of course, in respect to the situation now where the business is managed completely by multinational companies. So this is also an interesting point to be discussed. And GDPR. GDPR is affecting a lot of our activity, and also the platform, the data platform, the data vault is affected by damage, by these law regulations, and we are trying to see how we can suggest a better implementation of a GDPR and how we can use the GDPR rule inside the platform in order they are comfortable for users. For example, we can say that probably the GDPR rule are not adequate for some kind of data collection, in particular when we are able to collect anonymous or data associated to generic personas, so not personal data. Why it is so necessary that to use the very complicated procedure foreseen by the GDPR about the consensus and things like that. We need to think a little bit about that. So the bureaucracy around the GDPR and the privacy need to be analyzed and simplified if possible. So the platform, the DataVault platform, is trying to offer tool to test also this and to try a different way to achieve that. So I think I have finished. I hope to have provided an overview of what we are trying to do as a public administration with the data platform, and we'll see at the end of the project about the results that we hope that will be very, very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you, Paolo. And everybody is welcome to ask questions, Paolo, in the chat. And hopefully we will have some time left at the end also to answer them, or Paolo will answer them directly in the chat. So our next speaker is Sotiris Kousouris, Managing Director of Suite5. Sotiris?
Hey, thank you, Yuri, and thanks to all the previous presenters. So this will be the last presentation of this session, and I will try to shed some light on the key technologies that could be used and should be invested in for personal data spaces, but those more or less are also technologies that could apply to other kind of data spaces. In this case, we have personal data, which are more or less a bit more sensitive and have some peculiarities that call for different handling in some ways. So, as I say, as Yuri introduced me, I'm Sotiris. I'm working in the DataVaults project, having, let's say, the main technology responsibility. And my area of expertise is more or less on data analytics and AI, and actually data-driven technologies. So I'm by profession, I'm a computer and software engineer. And in this project, we're trying actually to bring forward, as you may have guessed by the title of this session and by what was explained previously by the different speakers, a kind of a mini personal data space or an experimental approach towards a personal data space. So this is essentially what DataVaults is. You can see it as a data marketplace that actually brings together data owners and data seekers. On the one hand, we have infrastructure that we called a personal app, so software and infrastructure that resides at the end of the data owner to collect and push their data to a platform, a cloud-based platform, which is essentially the core point of this data space. And in this actual quest and in this journey, all these 2 years, we learned a lot. And our presentation, our last presentation, will actually try to highlight quite briefly what could be done and which are the key points that one has to consider when he would like to provide such a solution as a personal data space. So the first thing that we learned is that sourcing data and collecting data and extracting data in order to be used is a great challenge. We'll talk about all these five bullets in a while. The second one is that in such a data space, and especially because it concerns personal data, trust and security is of utmost importance. Moreover, there should be compliance with the legislation. It's something that is quite critical. It's imperative to be there, and it's actually something that is necessary. And then also there is a need to actually provide a very good UX. I'm not talking about UI, I will explain the difference, and explainability to the users of such a solution in order to gain audience and not lose it. And finally, there is, of course, a key question that applies to all data space of how is data valued, and not necessarily in monetary terms, but also in other dimensions, in order to actually be able to provide the incentives to different users to utilize such platforms, come on board, and actually take part in this sharing ecosystem. So we're going to talk a little bit about where we can find the data and how we can get it. And this is a core problem for any data space. However, when we are talking about personal data spaces, this is quite bigger. We are not talking about data getting drilled, let's say, out of some systems or out of just a single environment, which could be the case of an industrial data space, but we're talking about data that is produced by an individual. So we have one entity that is producing the raw data, but many different stakeholders that are actually getting this data and reaching this data. And in this process, what they do is that they use different types, data types, they use different structures, and they use different parts of the data and generate, of course, different insights. One would argue that that's okay because we are having now in Europe some regulations where you can get back your data and such stakeholders are actually in a place where they should not keep your data away from you. However, when you really try to do that in reality, you see that you just get different types of fruit. So I'm paraphrasing then when life give you lemons quote here. So there are no standardized data schemes. There are no standardized APIs to retrieve this data. And there are constant changes in how such operators provide this data. They make it quite hard for people and for other companies to get this data. And at the end, what you get is you get different parts and variants of same data. So even if it's, let's say, activity data, you will get it in different structure, different types. So as the image here suggests, green apples, red apples, and so on. So what we need here is that, first of all, we need to have some smart ways of fetching this data and support the schemes of authorizing ones, but retrieve constantly from different data providers. So I authorized my data to be downloaded, and this is done constantly as I produce the data. And of course, we need to have some new ways and tools using also state-of-the-art structures that are out there to enrich this data, transform them, and link them in formats that could be universally used by anyone. So apart from the data sourcing question, there are also quite a big question about trust and security. This is, as you can understand, highly important for personal data spaces. Trust matters, and it is a very big portion of the success of such platforms. So those platforms need to be trusted, first of all, by their users. They should clearly denote how they treat the data, how they control the data, and they also need to provide the necessary technology and trust and reliability guarantees. You need to know that you trust the system you're providing the data, and also the system needs to trust the user as well. So the users need to be identifiable, their devices probably should be authenticated, and there should be checks in order to see that the data that they're offloading there is actually authentic data, is non-tampered with, and cannot be used for any malicious activity or any activity that falls out of the scopes of such data space. So the technologies that should be used and where the focus should be when it comes to trust are on things like attestation rules and methods, on smart methods for on-premise or cloud-based data availability and analysis, and for managing identity in a trusted and universal way. So there are out there many different systems that do that. There are also European identity management providers like IDEAS or so. So there needs to be, a way to actually be able to authenticate and verify the correct identity of such users. However, trust is not the only part that is essential here, but it's also security. And this is actually a key thing because we're talking about data sharing. So one needs to be able to trust that his data are actually secured and are delivered to the anticipated and intended recipients in a way that cannot be, let's say, sniffed or whatever by intermediaries or other parties. So there needs to be ways to make this data secure, but yet have them discoverable and computable in order not to restrain the potential of such a data space. And of course, there need to be flexible access control mechanisms in order to refrain from having one-on-one relationships between how data is permissions are provided for accessing the data, but work on different schemes that allow much broader and flexible access control methods, however, without losing the control at the end. So the technologies that are there, which have been also meant by you in the beginning, have to do with things like attribute-based encryption, searchable encryption, and even we can go to things like functional or homomorphic encryption. And there are also quite many robust access control schemes like attribute-based encryption and so on. Nevertheless, though that all those technologies are there, they're coming, most of them, out of the crypto world, there are also many challenges to overcome. And the thing here is that those technologies have been produced actually without having in mind a certain specifics that data spaces have, like the amount of data, or like, you know, the velocity and the volume of the data you would like to encrypt, for example, or decrypt. And such stuff actually stuff are actually the ones that impose certain limitations. So if you would like to go into in the direction of searchable encryption, you might end up with non-performance systems. Or if you're working and thinking about applying functional encryption to some of your data, then you need to think very good in which parts of the data you should use it, because you cannot use it for any type you would like. So all these technologies are here to help. Nevertheless, more research is needed. And this is because we need to actually bridge the world of data science and data management with the world of crypto operations in order to make all those technologies actually performant, trusted, and fitting to the context of data spaces. Of course, it's not only about security and trust, but it's also about compliance and auditing of what is being done with the data. So Yuri talked a little bit about the legal and ethical framework that we have been building in DataVaults. That's a huge work. And it's true that actually compliance and evidence-based audits are things that can actually increase the overall trust of a platform. So there needs to be compliance both with regulations, but also with things like licensing and IPR things. And what is also important, and is a thing that is not tackled at the moment by data spaces, and it's quite hard to be tackled, to be frank, is how you can have auditable trails of the whole data lifecycle, from the beginning of data generation to the usage of the platform, also able to cover to the extent this is possible of off-platform usage of those kind of data. So there could be methods to be, there are methods to be employed to solve those problems or parts of those problems. We talked about GDPR compliant and IPR respective frameworks that have to be there and should be considered during the design time of the different services. Services should be built on those requirements. There are novel approaches that have to do with distributed ledgers and blockchain that could actually help a lot in writing down and documenting in an immutable manner how operations are performed, like data sharing, access controls, and so on. And one could also think about smart methods for the hybrid dataset composition in order to limit, for example, off-platform usage, meaning that you can, for example, get 90% of the data set and use it offline, but the 10% that is also crucial and you will need this should come always from an online source that you cannot access outside of the platform, and so on. But this, again, is something that is quite experimental. Further research needs to be done in those directions. But those are things that should be actually greatly considered. So I also talked about user experience, which is quite crucial for such platforms. And this is actually not UI, not how things should look and that they should look nice and pleasing, which is, a big plus, but also to work with the underlying structure of how a user is experiencing his journey over such a platform. You need to have something that is solid and robust in order not to provide at the end a very complex platform and scare users away, but actually to retain the users on the platform and make them want to use it. So as you all know, we're talking here about concepts like privacy, trust, which are quite hard to follow. And having all those options and all those check boxes and drop-down lists to actually satisfy those requirements in platforms are actually things that discourage users. Most of the users, we have to think that will be not of a very high level of IT literacy. And of course, this would mean they would not be able to understand such things. So we need actually services that could convey in a smart way the messages and the most important info, which has to do with privacy, security, and how those are used in the platform, and delivering them to the users on a mainstream level, allowing, of course, all the advanced users to use extra features that are provided by the platform. And of course, what is highly important is to take advantage of the devices or the that people already use, or take advantage on the ways that people access the internet and could access such platforms. So most of the people do it through their smartphones. So whatever we build should be more or less operating through a smartphone. You should not have the user actually working on another device that he's not comfortable with. So I'm trying to sum up. The last and big question here is about how one defines the value of the data, which is a huge question. Actually, it's very difficult to set a price on the data, and it's very difficult to understand how a data asset is generating value in the secondary market or in products and services they use it. So what we need is that we need to offer to users tools and methods that could actually track the value of the data sets that they offer and the value that those generate. And of course, also to find ways to give them motives to share more data, because we're not talking about monetary compensation here, but also of social value that could be accompanying this data, and they should be triggered to utilize such platforms, share more for the common good. So this is my last slide. I hope I'll finish on time. So all those data spaces are actually mountains that we would, somebody needs to climb in order to deliver something. So this is a picture of Mount Olympus in Greece. It's the the top of this mountain, and if somebody would like to reach there, it's a very tough trail. And the same tough trail is also for personal data spaces. So we need to actually invest more in research and in standardization in domains that have to do with data models, with crypto and trust operation, and of course with UX, making legislation and compliance more understandable to users. And in this quest, what is also needed is the support by the European Commission and of the different member states in order to actually have directives to impose that such standards and methods are to be used by any data processor to make things more interoperable, more user-friendly, and actually give back to the community a big part and portion of the value that they enjoy by processing all this data. So that will be all from my side, and thank you very much. Giving the floor back to Yuri now. I don't know if we have time for any question or I just...
Thank you, Satiris, for presentation. Unfortunately, actually, we don't have any time for questions. I think now 12:30, but maybe we could answer quickly one or two. One was maybe you could answer it as technical leader. It's about main differences of data vaults to the pods in a solid project, which was inspired or initiated by Tim Berners-Lee. If you know, if not, I could answer. If you prefer me to answer.
Yeah, Yuri, it's breaking up on my side, so maybe you answer.
Okay, so the difference, of course, we have a bit different approach compared to Solid, which is a very interesting initiative on semantic web technology for data sharing, I would call it like that. In our case, we are cover the full data value flow, starting from data collection, which is a huge challenge itself. And we also have data trading. And we are relying more on blockchain technology for smart contracts and data sharing. So we are a bit different, I think. So I don't know if Solid is using blockchain. I don't think so. But truth speaking, I don't know this side of. But the main difference is for sure what our scope is a bit wider when by them. So this is definitely a difference. Okay. I saw also another question in the chat. One moment. From Rigo Venning, do you use policy for data use limitations while sharing, which is to use it is, or this is just until ACL triggers and then out of control? We have done rights labeling beyond ACL in a special project. Special, it's the name of the project.
Yeah, I could answer to that quite fast because I can hear it. I was writing about that. Actually, in DataVaults, what we do is that we apply policies to the at the time when data is to be shared between from a user to the platform, and those actual policies are there and are imposed by the blockchain when somebody would like to get the data. But those are more or less policies that have to do with access to the data, and they describe how usage shall be done, though those are not imposed over the platform. So once somebody can take the data and download it, then it's out of control of the DataVaults platform.
Okay. I don't see more questions. Maybe I saw what Rigo is from W3C. So maybe it's interesting. We're also using W3C technologies, and our data model is a profile of DCAT, which we are extending in order to satisfy our needs for the categorizing data and categorizing data. And we are developing a special profile which would cover our needs for sharing personal data. So very welcome, and would like to exchange with anyone who is interested in the topic. Okay, thank you very much for joining our session. I hope it was interesting for you. The slides will be published by the organizers, and of course this video, I guess. Thank you, and I wish you other interesting sessions at this event.